Hello, my name is Junior Robinson, and I wanted to take a minute and tell you about a Forest Chicano Kids Tiawi Picture Company film project that I'm working on. '73 Chicanos in Wounded Knee tells the fiery story of the 1973 Wounded Knee occupation and Chicanos' solidarity in that struggle. These are stories that I grew up hearing bits and pieces of from aunts and uncles, and I am very excited to work on this film. And I am very humbled that I'm able to work with and bring you the first-hand accounts of some of these stories from some of the veteranos who were there at the Wounded Knee struggle. I appreciate any support and that you can give towards this film. Thank you. Take a look.
You are not an Indian, are you?
Huh?
I mean, this is...
Yeah, I'm a Chicano.
And why are the Chicanos here?
Well, so we're all together, see, we're all Native Americans. And, well, Chicano is part Indian. From his way back ancestors, and deep down in the heart, they're really involved. I'm speaking for the ones that are here, we are, and the ones across the country are starting to help us by protesting. And I think that we're going to come to this thing pretty good.
Here comes a brother, man, because in there we were all brothers and sisters. In there we were all brothers and sisters, and that's all we worked through, so it's a brother and sister. And we worked in committees. We did different things. Like I worked in the clinic. Other people worked in the kitchen. Other people ran food at night. I ran one mission one night. 56 hours after I got shot, because the same day that I got there, I got shot that night. I arrived about at 2:30 into Wounded Knee, and by 7:30, 8 o'clock, somewhere around there, I had already been blasted by a government machine gun.
We were all wounded at Wounded Knee, you and me. We were all wounded at Wounded Knee, you and me. In the name of manifest destiny, you and me.
I was laying on the ground, I remember thinking, shit, if I die here, my grandparents are going to read about it in the Rocky Mountain News. When I got shot, the MD that was there wanted to call a truce, cease fire, and get a helicopter and evacuate me to Denver or to Rapid City, where they had the proper facilities to deal with my injury. And Leonard Todak said, nah, this is my clinic and I'm chief of medicine here. I'm going to operate. And then the doctor they washed the wound out and they sutured me up and bandaged me. That by 10 o'clock that night, I was doing an interview with the media and I kicked everybody out except CBS. Leonard Kodak, what can I say? He saved my life in the time of danger when, you know, the doctor was wanting to call a ceasefire and call a helicopter and go through that scenario. And Leonard Kodak came over and he saw that he could do it. And he did it. And he did it better than the doctor could have done it. Broomfield. That's where the plane was. So I was given access to the plane, and it was full of fuel, and the keys were in it. My friend hauled all the food and everything. I loaded it, putting the heaviest things up front and the lightest things toward the back, so that I would have better control of the plane for a slow flight, you know, landing in a dirt road like that. So anyway, when I'm approaching to land, the brothers had promised me that they would cut the power lines. Anyway, there was no electricity, and the feds had already cut the juice off for us, so they were worthless.
Wounded Knee, this is Indian Flyer coming through the night. Is there a Carter camp down there?
This is Wounded Knee.
This is Indian Flyer. Give me a landing party.
Be advised, that plane is right over Wounded Knee. It just cut its light.
Where's Carter? Carter, damn it, get down here. You gotta see this.
Is he a bed?
Shoot down.
But they didn't cut the power lines and they didn't hang no strips of cloth on them either. They just left them there. So when I'm approaching, all of a sudden, with the lights of the airplane, I saw the power lines. And I freaked. I just yanked back as hard and as fast as I could on the control wheel and pulled the plane at an angle where it kept flying straight. Went right over the power lines and stalled. Hit the ground, bounced off three or four times like the Three Stooges. Finally, I got it running down the road, got it to the end of the road, turned it around, and put the brakes on. And right away, somebody opened the back door and started unloading the cargo. And I saw Daniel Vigil, and I remembered him because he was one of the ones that drug me back from where I was shot, back into the clinic. So I grabbed the carton of Salems. I knew he smoked Salems. And I grabbed Salems are cool, one of those. I grabbed whatever he smoked, a carton of them. And I threw them at him and I said, "That's for you, bro," and he caught it. And the rest of it was a big crate full of cartons of cigarettes and rice and beans and everything you could think of that you that wouldn't spoil, that would go a long ways and was nutritionally good.
No, don't shoot! Hold your fire for crying out loud!
I remember them shooting at me, but the Native Americans quickly called a stop to the shooting because they said it's one of ours. So I landed and a whole bunch of people rushed. There's a picture of it somewhere where they rushed the airplane and everybody started screaming my name. They recognized me.
Right, Rocky Madrid. How'd you made it, brother?
Oh, man, the whole country's talking about you guys. Yeah, poking a hornet's nest.
And then when after they unloaded the plane, then Leonard Krodog and this other guy, Owen Locke, climbed on. And Leonard Krodog told me, "You have to fly me back to Krodog's paradise." I told him, "I don't know where it's at, Leonard." He said, "I'll show you." So I said, "Okay, you navigate for me and we'll go there." I didn't realize it was that far. It's not very far, just over them hills over there. We went so flat where he lives. I landed right by his house, parked the plane right in front of his house, got down, had coffee with him and his family, and we chatted. I couldn't say no to the guy that has saved my life, you know? Couldn't say no to Leonard Krodog, even though that wasn't part of the flight plan. There's no way in the world I could say no to an elder like Leonard Krodog. Whatever he told me to do, I would have to jump up and do it. He told me to fly him there, and I flew him there.
Wounded Knee, you tell that pilot to shut down and stay right there. If he moves, we will open fire. You got that? We'll shoot his ass.
Says they still see the lights there.
Hey, who the hell is stepping on me? You get off the air, you go to Channel 3. Wounded Knee, we are going to shoot him down. Does the pilot know that?
Go, Rocky!
Go, Rocky! What do we do?
Go, Rocky, man!
Fire at will! Shoot him down!